Good evening.
Good evening
and welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, it is not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any church or religious organization. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to proving the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of eternal pattern, purpose, and plan operating throughout eternity until this present day. Excuse me. Now, this school is a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. And we were incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States and various parts of the world. The Ontario branch school was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we use and teach by the true and original name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Now, the true name for the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has also been improperly substituted by God. And the true name for the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and they are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lord's many and God's many. We now know that each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for Himself. Now, Jesus is a name, but Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters of the alphabet that would produce a sound that is made by this letter J. Mm-hmm. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Mm-hmm. Now, Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state is incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolized in His pure spirit state on this chart as a cloud. Now, Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize Himself because a cloud is no particular or descriptive shape and form. We've drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the whole creation abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word of Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. Now, this shape and form can only be seen in a divine vision and understood in a divine revelation. Later on, the self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth being as Yahshua the Messiah. The world calls him Jesus Christ. There was only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title could be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by a divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. Now, after Yahweh Elohim led the children of Israel up out of Egypt, he called Moses on top of Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. Now this pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and korban habah. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. Also in this book, we go forth to prove that everything in the creation abides, is made and operates according to the structure and function of the threefold tabernacle pattern, and absolutely nothing escapes this pattern. Now the 10 primary constitutional objectives or aims listed to it as follows. Number one is to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Two is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without the distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, modern practical, and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstitions, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensation and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. And the eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith that was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. And ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man must be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the newer state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. Tonight we'll have a prayer to start for class with Dr. Samuel Salas.
Scripture.
Yeah, our scripture lesson is 1 Corinthians, first chapter. Scripture reader would be Dr. Joe Williams.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
Time of prayer. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, for all the blessings we receive from you. This wonderful teaching is hard to explain, but it's being understood by the sons you choose to share. Make this teaching possible for everyone to understand, easy and simple. And we are your faithful sons, the one here and the ones around the world who watching these classes. I encourage them to keep looking into. This is a wonderful, wonderful mysteries, and our Yahweh himself revealed to us right here in this class. I say all those things in your own inside name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let's all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'll be reading the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament. Critically compare with ancient authorities the various manuscripts revived by the late A.B. Trainer of the Scripture Research Association, College Park, Maryland. I'll be reading 1 Corinthians, the first chapter, found on 220 in the back of the book. Saul, called to be an apostle of Yahshua Messiah through the will of Yahweh, and Sotis, our brother, unto the assembly of Yahweh, which is at Corinth, to them that are sanctified in Yahshua the Messiah, called to be sons, with all that in every place call upon the name of Yahshua Messiah, our Savior, both heirs, both theirs and ours. Grace be unto you and peace from Yahweh our Father, and from Yahshua the Messiah. I thank my Elohim always on your behalf for the grace of Yahweh, which is given you by Yahshua Messiah, that in everything ye are enriched by him in all utterance and in all knowledge, even as the testimony of the Messiah was confirmed in you, so that ye come behind in no gift, waiting for the coming of our Savior, Yahshua Messiah, who shall also confirm you unto the end, that ye may be blameless in the day of our Savior, Yahshua Messiah. Yahweh is faithful, by whom ye were called unto the fellowship of his Son, Yahshua Messiah, our Savior. Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Savior, Yahshua Messiah, that ye all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, but that ye be perfectly joined together, the same mind and the same judgment. For it hath been declared unto me of you, my brethren, by them which are of the house of Chloe, that there are contentions among you. Now this I say, that every one of you saith, I am Saul, and I of Apollo, and I of Kepha, and I of the Messiah. Is the Messiah divided? Was Saul crucified for you? Or were ye immersed in the name of Saul? I thank Yahweh that I immersed none of you, but Crispus and Gaius, lest any should say that I had immersed in my own name. And I immersed also the household of Stephanias. Besides, I know not whether I immersed any other. For the Messiah sent me not to immerse, but to preach the gospel, not with wisdom of words, lest the cross be of the Messiah should be made of none effect. For the preaching of the cross is to them that is perished foolishness. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved it is the power of Yahweh. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribes? Where is the disputer of this age? Have not Yahweh made foolish the wisdom of this age? For when in the wisdom of Yahweh, the world by wisdom knew not Yahweh, it pleased Yahweh by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. For the Jews require a sign, and the Greeks seek after wisdom, but we preach the Messiah crucified, unto the Jews a stumbling block, and unto the Greeks foolishness. But unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, the Messiah is the power of Yahweh and the wisdom of Yahweh. Because of the foolishness of Yahweh is wiser than men, and the weakness of Yahweh is stronger than men. For ye see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But Yahweh hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and the weak things of the world to confound the things that which are mighty, and base things of the world, and things which are despised that Yahweh chosen, yea, and things which are not, to bring to naught things that are. That no flesh should glory in his presence. But of him are ye in the Messiah Yahshua, who of Yahweh is made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, that accordingly, as it is written, he that glorifieth, let him glory in Yahweh. That is 1 Corinthians, the first chapter. Let's all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you. Okay, tonight's our workshop night. It's good to see us here, those that could be here. You know, the world's out there celebrating these holidays or holy days, as they name them out there in the world. You know, something's been on my mind. These little esoteric sayings the founder would say, like he says, Yahweh is in his holy temple, let the world be silent. You know, and those things kind of make you think, you know. So, without further ado, our first speaker will be our instructor, one of our instructors, Dr. Will Williams.
Hmm. out here. As we said, considering that we're in the season of massive pagan holidayism, so all that, so forth and so on, I'm already tired of it, but that's all right. It's just, yes, it's part of the world. Mm-hmm. Anyway, any questions, comments, anything anybody want to bring up? I enjoyed Mitch's lecture Sunday. You know, the only part that always gets to me, Mesa, is, you know, like this thing, you know, this exercise I bring up, you know, it ran a lot of people away, and that was never my intention. You know, if it embarrassed somebody, I'll look into the camera. If it embarrassed anybody out there, I am truly sorry. It was not my intention, honestly. I mean, I designed it for an 11-year-old girl for a child, okay? And
that's it right there. That's it right there.
But see, here's the thing. The scripture says we all have to come like children, okay?
People don't believe that.
All right? You know, it happened to me too, all right? Okay, I had to go through a regeneration. You know, it's like if I had to compare it to a Monopoly game, it was like, you know, do not pass go, do not collect $200. You know, go directly to jail. Right? Right. So I mean, boy, I'm trying not to get political, man, but golly, it's like church. People sit up and brag and say, we're still not a church, but yet you act like church more than anything.
That's right. That's true.
When some like school type things are implemented, you know, then you bark and you rebel at it.
Right, you rebel, yeah.
You know, but you said it was a school, not a church.
Right.
I have never gotten that, honestly. Mm-hmm. And if you really want to know my feelings on it, go watch the Lee Warren interview, because what he says about IDMR is pretty much how I feel about it. You know, really, pretty much how, you know, and really, because my thing is always this. How is it that, you know, an organization that had received, you know, and became entrusted with a great, stupendous, colossal, panoramic vision, and yet have very little insight? You know, explain that one to me. And I'm just as guilty because I've been in this for 40 plus years, so I'm just as guilty, I'm just as stupid. Mm-hmm. And just as uninsightful as the next person. So I don't have no preeminence over anybody on that, you know. We all were. Mm-hmm. You know. I mean, gosh, I don't know what to say. I mean, and that still bothers me, what Reggie said. You know, I mean, that really does. That bothers me. You know, that some people, you know, because, I don't know, for whatever reason, they felt embarrassed. Mm-hmm. You know, and it was not meant to embarrass anybody. It was meant to enlighten. It was meant to edify. Okay? So, like I said, please come back.
There you go.
Like I said, that's all I can say. Please come back. And Reggie said, I'm the one doing the work now, so you ain't got to do nothing. You know? Except maybe put your hand in the jar. Okay, there's a number for you, Mr. Will. Yeah.
Yeah.
Now you get up and, you know, yeah, just make a pack mule out of me. Okay? Fine. I'll be that. If that's what it takes. You know, and then you can, you know, take the lessons, instruction, and you can go home and play with it yourself. If that makes you feel more comfortable.
Right.
You know, I mean, it was not, you know, we're not trying to find out or trying to show somebody, you know, how smart we are, who's got the IQ or this, that, and the other. See, if I have learned anything over the years, that scripture, 1 Corinthians 12th chapter,
Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant. Ye know that ye were heathens, carried away unto these dumb idols, even as ye were led. Wherefore I give you to understanding that no man speaking by the Spirit of Yahweh calleth Yahweh, Yahshua, cursed, and that no man can say that Yahshua is the Savior but by the Holy Spirit. Now there are diversities of gifts, but of the same Spirit.
I said, now there are diversities of gifts.
Right.
But the same Spirit. Mm-hmm. See, breathe.
And there are differences of administrations.
Uh-huh.
But the same Elohim.
Breathe.
And there are diversities of operations.
Mm-hmm.
But it's the same Elohim which worketh all in all.
It's the same Elohim. See, it worketh all in all. Just like your body. Your physical body has different systems in it. 10 of them all together. But they all work together for the benefit of the whole. Read.
But the ministration, but the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit withal.
Mm-hmm.
For to one is given by the Spirit of the word of wisdom,
uh-huh.
to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit.
That's it. Now he's running them off, but if you count them up, there should be 9 of them, okay? So now he's counting them up. He says, for one by the Spirit is given the word of wisdom, that's 1. Another the word of knowledge, that's 2. Read.
To another faith by the 3. Same Spirit. To another, the gifts of healing by the same Spirit.
4.
To another, the working of miracles.
9.
To another, prophecy. To another, discerning spirits. To another, various kinds of tongues. To another, the interpretation of tongues.
Mm-hmm.
But all these worketh that one and the self-same Spirit.
How many did you get mentioned?
It was 9.
That's what I thought. There's 9. Okay. See, but these 9... But all these work as that one in the very self-same Spirit. These 9 work as one, which is 10. You know, 0 is a placeholder. See, just as your 9 systems are encapsulated in the 10th system of your body, which is your skin, otherwise known as the integumentary system.
Right.
But the point is, there are diversities of gifts, and everybody has them. Mm-hmm. See, and see, not just on an individual level, but it also works, it's the same way with classes, mm-hmm. on a branch level.
That's right.
Right.
See, every branch has their character,
right.
their gift, the diversity of gift. I mean, there are classes that do certain things better than other right. classes. Our class, we do a certain thing better than some other classes, whereas other classes concentrate on certain aspects of the doctrine better than what we do. And, if, and you wouldn't know that unless you like, you know, especially the ones that are online, you sample them all, like a smorgasbord. And you say, oh, okay, well, I can get a little bit of this here. I can go over here and get something over here. Over here, I can get some of this over here. See? It's diversity of gifts. But it's the same Spirit that's giving it all. Can we read some more?
11. But all these worketh that one in the self-same Spirit, divided to every man severally, as he will. For as one body, as for the body is one, and hath many members, and all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is the Messiah. For by one Spirit are we all immersed into one body, whether it be Jews or Greeks, whether we be bond or free, or have been all made to drink into one Spirit. For the body is not one member, but many. If the foot shall say, because I am not the hand, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? And if the ear shall say, because I am not the eye, I am not of the body, it is therefore not of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where were the earring? If the whole were hearing, where were the smelling? But now hath Elohim set the members, every one of them, in the body, as it hath pleased him.
Mm-hmm.
And if they were all one member, where were the body? But now are they many members, yet but one body. And the eye cannot say unto the hand, I have no need of thee.
Mm-hmm.
Nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. Nay, much more those members of the body which seem to be more feeble are necessary. And those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, upon these we bestow more abundant honor, and our uncomely parts are more abundant comeliness. For our comeliness parts are no need, have no need, but Elohim have tempered the body together, having given more abundant honor to that part which lacketh,
mm-hmm.
that there should be no division in the body, but that the members should have the same care one for another.
See, that's the thing, because there was a question that was brought up recently about how do you know when you have the Holy Spirit or when you come into the kingdom, when you love the brotherhood. Mm-hmm. And that's represented physically by the circulatory system in your body. Because the circulatory system passes blood throughout all the system, because all the systems need oxygenated blood.
Right.
See, even the parts that are bad, like if you got a cancer, the circulatory system is going to feed it too.
Right.
No matter what. Right. It's not discriminatory in that sense. Because it's going to go throughout the whole body. See? Because it's going to have because there's a care there. I mean, inherent in that. I'm just using that as one example as far as one system in the body. But all the systems are like that. All the systems work that way. Because all the systems intersect with each other. And they all depend on each other for their interaction and their livelihood, if I can put it like that. I didn't mean to make it sound like a pun. But these systems, they work together. Okay? Read.
And were the one member suffering, all the members suffered with it.
Mm-hmm.
Or one member be honored, all the members rejoice with it. Now ye are the body of the Messiah, and members in particular. And Yahweh has set some in the assembly. Mm-hmm. First apostles, secondarily prophets, thirdly teachers. After that, miracles, then gifts of healing, helps, government, diversities of tongue. All are apostles.
So we turn it again.
Are all apostles?
Mm-hmm. Now is everybody an apostle? Well, now this is at the time when Paul said that. This is in the fifth dispensation. Are all apostles? No, at that time, no. Read.
Are all prophets?
Are all prophets? No.
Read. Are all teachers?
Read. No.
Are all workers of miracles?
No.
Have all the gifts of healing?
No.
Do all speak with tongue?
No.
Do all interpret?
No.
But covet earnestly the best gift, and yet show I unto you a more excellent way.
Okay, now before we even get to that excellent way, when Paul said that, that was back here in the fifth dispensation. And that was what was dispensed at that time.
Very good. That's right.
See? Here, we're in the sixth dispensation. See? Now, if you were to ask those same questions now, because see, back here, yeah, there was division in the sense that, well, everybody's not an apostle. Everybody's not a prophet. Everybody's not a teacher. Everybody, you understand? But now, down here, in the sixth dispensation, the dispensation of the double portion, this is what's happening. Now, go back to that scripture where you started off, was it all apostles?
Okay.
maybe I'll start above that.
Okay. And 28 verse. And Yahweh has set some in the assembly, first apostles.
Okay, now that's what happened back here in this dispensation. But now we're in this dispensation. So read.
Secondarily, prophets.
Go back and read that again.
And Yahweh set some in the assembly, first apostles. Secondarily, prophets. Thirdly, teachers.
No, there's something you're missing. Something you're missing the verse. Are all apostles?
Oh, further down. I was coming up to these. You go a bit higher. Okay.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, that's before that.
Yes.
Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead and read.
And Yahweh has set some in the assembly, first apostles.
Uh-huh.
Secondarily, prophets.
Uh-huh.
Thirdly, teachers. After that, miracles. Then gifts of healing, helps, government, diversity of tongue,
mm-hmm.
are all apostles.
Okay, now at that time, see, that's what it was, but now we're in this time. So before, I answered no, because that was in the fifth dispensation. But now, in the sixth dispensation, are all apostles? Yes. Read.
Are all prophets?
Yes.
Are all teachers?
Yes.
Are all workers of miracles?
Yes.
Have all the gifts of healing?
Yes.
Do all speak with tongues?
Yes.
Do all interpret?
Yes.
But covet earnestly the best gifts, and yet show I unto you a more excellent way.
Read.
Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, and have not love,
uh-huh.
I am become a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal.
So what is that talking about? Love. It's really talking about the Holy Spirit. But now we're looking at it dispensationally. Because see, now we're in the dispensation of the double portion. What double portion? The double portion of you receiving the Holy Spirit and you giving it. Because that's what's happening now. We're all apostles now. Everything what he just read, we all have that. If you choose to exercise it. We all have that. But Yahweh, he's going to move. The Spirit is going to move us in whatever direction. But we all have access to this now. It's not like a thing. I said, well, I got to go to some brother because he's got a gift for healing. Well, look. We all have a gift for healing now. I talked about this before. Back here in the fifth dispensation. Only the apostles could give the Holy Spirit. What does that mean? Because the apostles were the eyewitnesses. We read the story in Acts about Philip, how he went down there and he healed them folks. He did miracles. He had the gift of miracles. And preached unto them, but he could not convey the Holy Spirit. Peter and John had to come down and talk to them. And when they talked to them, that's when they received the Holy Spirit because they were apostles. That changed here in the sixth dispensation when Dr. Kinley moved the sixth over to here. And up to that point, Dr. Kinley spoke at every convention that he was involved in, except the last one, the 75. And it was always said, come to the convention. Why? Because you couldn't be sealed. How? Because the apostle, Henry Clifford Kinley, was going to speak there. The Holy Spirit, and you can receive that. Because he was going to speak there. But the last convention in 75, he did not speak. But he passed it on to his lieutenants. They got up and spoke. And through them, all received the Holy Spirit. See, it's all. See, you have to put it in. That's why even Paul says this. Said, look, you have to rightly divide the ages and dispensations. You have to know what age you're in, what dispensation you're talking about. What's being dispensed. You know, the perspective of all of this. We went through it, the other Sunday, about these dispensations being that link, or that, you know, links together. And this represents a chain that binds the mystery of iniquity. All of that. It's all comparative. It's all related, but you have to, boy, you have to put it in perspective. You have to rightly divide. I guess that's what the term I'm saying. Rightly divide. But with these gifts and talents, there are things that if you take the time and look, you would be surprised what you can do. I mean, I find out things, I mean, over the last 20 years, 30 years that I do now that I would have never thought I'd be doing at this point in my life. But I'm doing it because it's the Spirit that allows me to do it. Put it like that. Okay? I guess that answered that. You want to say something, Richie?
Let's go back to the first chapter.
Yeah.
In the 10th verse.
Okay.
Where it says, now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Savior, Yahshua the Messiah.
You got a microphone? Give him a microphone.
I'm going to sit back there.
Yeah. Oh, you want to, yeah, okay. You want to read scripture? That's always welcome.
Stuff anyway.
That's always welcome.
This 10th verse says, now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Savior, Yahshua the Messiah, that ye all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, and that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. For it hath been declared unto me of you, my brethren, by them which are of the household of Chloe, that there are contentions among you. Now this I say, that every one saith, one of you saith, I am a Saul, and I am Apollos, and I am a Kepha, and I am a Messiah. Is the Messiah divided? Was Saul crucified for you? Or were ye immersed in the name of Saul? I thank Yahweh that I immersed none of you but Caiaphas and Gaius.
Gaius.
Now, everybody reads that. So how do they interpret that? Because it's telling you that we all should speak the same thing and there be no divisions among you. Mm-hmm. And it was like that.
Sure.
Yeah, it was like that.
Mm-hmm.
But now it's divisions among you and everybody don't speak the same thing. Even though they have the same charts and the same aims and objections, and they do not teach the same thing anymore.
Yeah, well, as our founder said, you have folks creep in unaware, and they're raising up, that was gonna, been around a long time, that's gonna say things contrary to what's been said, mm-hmm. or taught. See, the thing that gets me is these adjectives and adverbs they be using, because they'll get to the point. See, if Kinley is the seventh angel, then you're really not going to have anything that's going to supersede him or what he taught, I put it like that. Because that's what he's saying. It's not about Kinley. It's what you see
mm-hmm.
illustrated on these charts. That's the testimony of the seventh angel. Okay? So now, you have to take that into consideration. And I just don't see, and people do try to say they supersede what's on here and what's been taught. And you can tell by the adverbs and adjectives. I don't know why you're being so fidgety back there.
Got neuropathy.
That was a good one.
I can see the mic. Be thankful there's no big monitor. Okay? I can only see on one side of the room, now I'm distracted.
People say.
I'm sorry, what?
The people are saying, using adjectives.
Well, yeah, the seventh angel. Yeah, that's now what I would say. Adverbs and adjectives. That's what. Because people would say, Kinley lied to us. Kinley deceived us. Right. Kinley tricked us. Kinley fooled us. Mm-hmm. What else? Kinley misdirected us. Or what? You know.
I heard that one.
That yeah, one. That's. You have to go read the. Yeah. And and so. What are you going to say? You can't, these are folks you really can't convince, You have to do a little closer shot that looks, that's called a cowboy shot, if I had my holster on, come in, there you go, I'm not going to kiss you, right there, it's fine, see? All right, now. Yeah, and that's the thing, and these, look, we're not worshiping these charts. Even Dr. Kinley would say that they're limited, as far as scope and depth, and they're pictorial illustrations, but they're just there because we're in the flesh, we're physical, our eyesight is our highest sense, so therefore it appeals to us. We can look at the bright colors. We can make the lines and correlations and stuff. But it's just there as a guide. Because I'm going to get into this chart Sunday. It's just a guide to get you to look inward.
Right.
That's really the whole point of all of this. to look at yourself. I mean, and really, and stop and think. You must be a pretty hard-headed person if it takes seven charts, all these charts, you know, to illustrate and just to get your attention and to get inside your head and to show you what you are and what you haven't been and what you could be. You know, I mean, that's just, I mean, I would, that should tell you something right there, okay? And that's the thing, and that's, and going through these correlations on these charts help to help us to understand the purpose of Yahweh and what is and what he's doing from eternity to eternity, that is to say, from the ages, from one end to the other, see? And, hey, what did he say? My pickle jar over here. Call my pickle jar, man. Say this ran off a lot of folks. The shake scared them away. Rally of the bones. I have something in my hand. Can you zoom out? You have some good things to do. There you go. I guess it sounded like bones, you know. Oh, them bones, jumping bones, them bones, jumping bones. I don't know. Why would you be afraid of learning? You know, I mean, my gosh, you know, this was the embarrassment that great, Reggie? I don't know, because nobody tells me anything, except one lady did tell me she was scared to death of me. She did tell me that once.
Which one was that?
That was Carla. Hi, Carla. You still watching? That's Carla, right? Just say that. I don't know. Why am I sticking my hand in there?
Okay,
I
have a stick.
Huh?
Go ahead, do it.
Why? Why should? Okay, I guess I can do it. Which means I gotta do 38, 39, and 40, you know. Oh my gosh. The end is nigh. What can I say? I know he's in the midst. He's in the midst of the seven branch lampstand. That is true. But this is not the seventh age or the sabbatical age. This is not, that's not what this is representing here. Some people think that, but it's not. And here's the reason why. Here's the sabbatical age right here. New heaven, new earth, plate 39. This is the renovation of the earth. This is the new earth state. If I was to look at this by the ages, this would be the fifth age. This veil step would be the sixth age. And the Sabbath, or the all in all, the sabbatical age would be right here. And this is Elohim, see. Let's put it like this. This is Elohim. Eschatology, the end of the end. This is eschatology. This is Elohim coming through the veil. Appearing, universally being revealed to the world. He's already universally revealed to everybody in this room, to us. We already know that. Even Dr. Kinley would tell you that. I heard it on the tape. saying that he's already universally revealed to us, but not to the world. But how will that happen? Through us. Because when Elohim appears in their consciousness, we appear with him.
Right.
Right.
See? And that's what it says, immortality. Elohim revealed from heaven. What heaven? Space? No. That's the first heaven. The atmospheric heaven, which is the second heaven? No. But from the third heaven, from eternity. Where is that at? Right in here.
Right.
Right in here. That's the veil. See, the veil that has to be ripped. See, the human race is a veil.
Very good.
Because we're all one body. Yes. We're all one flesh. We all come from one man. We're already one in the flesh. All 7.5 billion of us. We're already one in the flesh. So that's a veil that's gotta be rent. That is to say transverse, because see, Elohim being seen by 7.5 billion people is not going to happen from atmospheric heaven. It's not going to happen from space. It's going to happen from eternity.
Right.
Okay? This is a descending plate. And see, it talks about immersion to the lake of fire. This is what Dr. Kinley said. You're already in the lake.
Mm-hmm. Already. That's right. Already.
You're already in the lake. So what does that mean? See, now it says lake of fire, but you have to understand, these are all types and shadows to get you to understand a principle. Mm-hmm. See, the principle is that, see, that these folks here, see, they have on what is called filthy rags. What do you mean? The concepts, the opinions, the hypotheses, the theories that they held.
Right. Okay.
That's what they have. These are the things they've been clothed upon. Right here. These are the things they've been clothed upon.
Okay.
There's a parable. There's a parable, if I can find it. Yeah, there's a parable that I think Yahshua made, if I can find it. Matthew 22:10.
Matthew 22:10. So those servants went out.
get above that. Start with 22:1.
And Yahshua answered and spake unto them again by parable and said, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a certain king which made a marriage for a son, and sent forth his servants to call them that were bidden to the wedding, and they were to come. Again he sent forth another servant, saying, tell them which are bidden, behold, I have prepared my dinner, my oxen and my fatlings are killed, and all things are ready. Come unto the wedding, come unto the marriage. But they made light of it and went their way, one to his farm, another to his merchandise. And the remnant took his servants and treated them spitefully and slew them. But when the king heard thereof, he was wroth, and he sent forth his army and destroyed those murderers, and burned up their cities. Then said he to his servants, the wedding is ready, but they which are bidden were not worthy. Go ye therefore into the highways, and as many as ye shall find, bid to the marriage. So those servants went out into the highways and gathered together all as many as they found, both bad and good. And the wedding was furnished with guests, And when the king came in to see the guests, he saw there a man which had not on a wedding garment. And he said unto him, Friend, how camest thou in hither, not having a wedding garment? And he said, and he was speechless. Then said the king to the servants, Bind him hand and foot, and take him away, and cast him into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen.
Okay. Yeah. Now, it was about now a wedding. It was a wedding, and then this guy got in the wedding, but he didn't have a garment on. See, now what does that mean? He didn't have the Holy Spirit.
Very well said.
That's what it was. See, he wasn't clothed in the Holy... He was not clothed in the Holy Spirit, but he had his own garments on. And so when the husbandman came, the master of the feast came and saw him and said, well, friend, how came you in here without a garment? How came you in here without a garment? See, he had his own garment on. That's what's going to happen here. See, this is a marriage feast, so to speak. The universal revelation of Yahshua as far as the whole age is concerned. See, there will be those at the wedding feast, at this wedding feast, that are not in IDMR. That are not in class, so to speak. Mm-hmm. Because we just read, go out on the highway, bring them all in.
Right, good and bad.
Good and bad. So there's going to be folks, so that tells you right there, everybody, is going to be... They're not all in IDMR.
Very well said.
So they're gonna bring them all in, and then somebody gonna try to sneak in and say, "Wait a minute, friend, how did you come in here without a wedding garment?" And the guy was like, "He was speechless." Security. bind him up, hand him foot, and throw him out. Throw him into the outer darkness.
Right. Okay.
Throw him into the outer darkness. Okay. Now that's descending. Alright? And this is all, what with fire, all this is talking about is a transmutation. See, the renovation is just a transmutation. See? So because that's how it all came in. It came in by transmutation. So it has to be the same way. And see, all this here, see, what you're seeing illustrated here is just a reference. See, just like here, just draw a line. Over here, this plate here. See, this is similar with the man was up in the garden, the man was cast out of the garden. The man was cast out of the garden, and the woman followed him out.
That's right.
Over here. Here's the man. The man going back into the garden, but this time the woman, the new earth is the woman. Reconstituted, the bride cleaned up, whatever you want to say. The new earth, the woman or the bride following the man back into the garden. Or in other words, the fifth age, the sixth age, the seventh age. Go to the textbook. To the ages and dispensations. First Bible. Page 93.
The importance of rightly dividing the seven dispensations and ages. Time begins and ends within the realm of eternity. Therefore, we must bear in mind, remember and know the difference between the age and the others, the difference between one dispensation and the other. The following definitions of an age and dispensation were taken from a Webster dictionary. Age, a particular period of time of history, or distinguished from another, a historical or geological period, epoch. For example, Each age is approximately 2,000 years long. The answer to living age is a short age of 1,656 years. The post-Diluvian age is a long age of 2,377 years. While the present age must be a short age, see chart opposite, page 94.
Okay, now, before you read the chart, read the definition of dispensation there.
Dispensation, the divine ordering of affairs of the world, be an appointment or arrangement by as by Yahweh. C, a divinely appointed order or system.
Okay. Now, let's break this down. We've got the ages here. I want you to read the dispensation list first.
Dispensation. The Edenic 1, 2.
Wait. Let's just take your time. What does it say?
The Edenic.
The Edenic. We have up here Adamic, okay, and we have to get into a long conversation about what the difference between Adamic and Adamic transgression. But for the moment, we'll say this. The Edenic or the Adamic dispensation, that started here. But see, look here on this chart. See, you see the word Garden of Eden, and it's on this side of this line, which was in this age. And there was no time because the sun was placed in the zenith of the sky. Now, when the transgression happened, the Adamic dispensation, see, when the Elohim came to Adam and told Adam and Eve and the serpent what would befall them, that was the Adamic dispensation. What was told to Adam, just paraphrase it, he was told he would have to work by the sweat of his brow, thorns and thistles, what he would get. Told the woman she would bear, she would be saved in childbearing. Told the serpent that dust shall he eat. All the days of his life and on the ground he would have to crawl. That's the Adamic dispensation. And see, and that closed the creative age. That closed this age and opened the antediluvian age. Okay? So that's what dispensations can do. Dispensations can open an age and they can close an age. And their divine orderings of affair by Yah, it was Yahweh that divinely ordered what was going to happen in that dispensation. And it was through a man, through the man Adam. And look, that dispensation lasted even beyond Adam's life. He lived 930 years. When he died, that dispensation did not die. It lasted until another man whom Yahweh divinely appointed. Okay. To take it, to take over, to link up, because as I said, these dispensations are like links in a chain. He would be, Noah would be the next link. But the point I'm making is the Adamic dispensation lasted from the time of the end of the creative age until Noah's commissioned to preach, even beyond Adam's death. So certain events say, like Enoch, for example. Enoch was translated. He was translated 57 years after the death of Adam. But it was in the Adamic or Edenic dispensation. Even after Adam's physical demise. See, it was still the Adamic or Edenic dispensation. Okay? Okay. All right. I'm about ready to read some more. Okay, so that's the Adamic or Edenic. That's the first dispensation. Okay.
The Noahic.
Then we got the Noahic. As I said, that's the connecting link because Noah was commissioned. All right. And he talked about a flood. And that dispensation closed the antediluvian age and opened the post-diluvian age. Okay. Continue.
The Melchizedek.
The Melchizedek dispensation, okay? And Abrahamic promises we got up here. This is a dispensation of faith. Does it have something next to it?
Abrahamic.
Yeah, Abrahamic. Uh-huh. This is the Abrahamic dispensation. Or a dispensation of faith. Okay? That's what's happening here. This is not closing an age or opening. This is just a standalone dispensation. All right. If you're going to shoot, you're going to have to get me in because you got me all cut off over there. Zoom out just a little. See,
I have to teach on the fly. Just, yeah, that one, no, yeah, just, there you go. See, you can, these are tools you have to look at to kind of balance and, you know, that kind of thing. Now, this is dispensation of faith, okay? In other words, Abraham believed the witnesses that was given to him, and it was accounted unto him for righteousness. What witnesses was that? What witnesses are there? The spirit, the water, and the blood. Or death, burial, resurrection. And it was accounted to him for righteousness. All right? Next.
The Mosaic.
The law. The Mosaic dispensation, or the dispensation of the law. When Elohim spoke the commandment from Mount Sinai down the mount. Something else I want to bring up since I said it. See, when the Israelites came up out of Egypt, they resurrected out of Egypt under the dispensation of faith. Mm-hmm. And then got to Mount Sinai, and that's when Elohim spoke down the Ten Commandment law in the hearing, and that began the dispensation of the law. See, what we call the Mosaic law, because of the tables of stone, plus there were 613 ordinances all together that was given. The dispensation of the law, okay? A covenant that was given unto Israel, all right? Read.
The
church age. Is there anything else?
Grace.
The grace. The church age. That's the fifth dispensation that came after the death, burial, resurrection, and ascension, and outpouring of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. The church means the assembly, the spiritual assembly, or the spiritual body of Yahshua, the age of grace. Why grace? That's why we got this line here, promise fulfilled. See, because the Abrahamic promise was simply this, that through faith, that through one man, through his seed, singular, all the families of the earth would be blessed. That seed was Yahshua the Messiah. So, because the promise was fulfilled, we are saved in this age by grace through faith. Mm-hmm. Okay? The fifth dispensation. Read.
Immortality, kingdom.
All right, the sixth dispensation. Immortality, kingdom. What does that mean? See, that means this, that now, not that it wasn't before, but now is now more made manifest that you have an immortal spirit dwelling in a mortal body. Not that it wasn't that way before, but because now of our position of where we're at now, we stand on the cusp of immortality. Elohim revealed from heaven. Immortality revealed from heaven. Not immortality revealed to us. That's already revealed to us. But now immortality revealed to everybody else. Doesn't mean they're going to be receiving it. Because see, hey, just like that guy, he was at the wedding party. He was there, probably got something to eat, saw the groom and the bride and all, you know. But hey, once he was found out, how'd you get in here without a garment? Security? Cast it to the outer darkness. Elohim. The whole thing is centered around Elohim. Read the next one. Yeah, maybe I can tie this up.
The sabbatical kingdom.
Right. And immortality, the seventh. That's why this word is here. Because some people say, well, why is the word Sabbath in the fifth age? That's not why it's here, because of the five. This word Sabbath is here because of this seven. Mm-hmm. See, because technically, when Dr. Kinley wrote about the number seven in the textbook, and he talked about the seven steps of the pattern, and he talks about seven days in a cycle of days, and ends with a seventh day, and so forth and so on. See, there are seven millenniums and a cycle of millenniums that ends with the Sabbath of immortality. And that's what he's talking about here. Okay, that's why the word Sabbath is here. A Sabbath of immortality. See, because you have to understand how... Acts 1, maybe 1 to 7... But keep your finger on the textbook. because we are coming back.
Acts 1 through 7?
1 and 7.
1 and 7.
Maybe I'm asking.
And he said unto them, it is not for you to know the time or the seasons, which the Father hath put in his own power.
Uh-huh.
But ye have received power after the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the world, of the earth. And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly towards heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Yahshua, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so in like manner, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven.
All right, and just see, the world believes he resurrected physical, so they believe he went up into atmospheric heaven physically. So therefore, they expect him to come back down from atmospheric heaven physically. That's what the world expects. But we understand that Yahshua resurrected a spiritual body. And that when he went into the cloud, see, this was a vision that was in their consciousness. See? So now if he left them, so to speak, and it was in a cloud, and it was a vision, then for him to reappear, it would have to be in a cloud, not the physical cloud. But in the cloud of their minds, and their brain. It would have to be in a vision. See, because that's how he left, so to speak, in a vision. So it would have to come back or appear again in a vision. Okay? Now keep reading.
Then returned they into Jerusalem from the mount called Olive, which is from Jerusalem in a Sabbath day's journey.
All right. Now that's the key right there. It was a Sabbath day's journey. This is the Mount of Olives. It was a Sabbath day's journey from the Mount of Olives back to Jerusalem. See, because on the Sabbath day, you couldn't do no work. See, and a Sabbath day's journey was like so many feet, you know, that you could walk. And it was just, it was a distance.
Restricted. This distance.
Yeah, it was the distance from the mount back to the city.
Yeah.
Just enough that you know you can come back to the city and go home. See, and not break the Sabbath, you know, so to speak. Because on the Sabbath you couldn't do no work.
Okay.
See? But this is a Sabbath day's journey. Alright, that's what happened there. Now the reason why I bring that up, because you see, that's why this word is here, Sabbath. Because see, Sabbath, a declared Sabbath in the seventh dispensation in the fifth age. From the fifth age to the seventh age is a Sabbath day's journey. Lake of Fire. From the fifth age, see the renovation. See, all of this is happening at the end of this age. The transmutation, when it says renovation, the transmutation. New Earth State. This is the fifth age. This is a sabbatical age. This is a Sabbath, put it like that. Mm-hmm. This is because the fifth age, what I showed you, fifth age, the seventh dispensation is sabbatical dispensation. That's the term I want.
Right.
All right? Fifth age. All right? From here to here. From the, this is Mount of Olives. From the Mount of Olives, in this sense, to Jerusalem is a Sabbath day's journey. And it's the man, and see, look, it's the man, again, it's Adam. Go back over here, draw a line. We see Adam here coming out of the garden, but the woman following him out. Here, the woman is clothed in the sun, but the man is going up here, and the woman clothed in the sun is following the man back in, into the garden. This is the fifth age. See, this is the sixth age, and I'm pointing to the veil. This is the seventh age, this is the Sabbath, or the all in all, all right? Now, let's go back to the textbook.
Okay.
And let's read the ages off.
The ages?
Yes.
Number one, the creator.
Okay, now number one, this is the creative age, right here.
Oh, number two, the antediluvian.
Hold on. The creative age, the first age. The beginning of this age is Elohim, who created the angelic creation. We got a dotted line here, and then the physical creation. All right? Both of them are in the realm of eternity, along with the Garden of Eden, as we explained earlier about the Adamic dispensation ending this creative age. All right, the second age, now you can read.
Number three, the post-diluvian.
The second age.
Oh, second age, the antediluvian.
Now, the second age is the antediluvian age. Ante means before, diluvian means flood. This simply means the age of the world before the flood, before the great deluge. All right, this is that age, and that age, again, started with the man coming out of the garden. All right, and it ended with Noah preaching about a flood, and the flood came. All right, go ahead.
Number three, the post-diluvian.
Now this is the post meaning after. The age after the flood. Diluvian means flood. The age after the flood, which was started by the flood, all right, and that ended with the death, burial, resurrection, and ascension, and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit of Yahshua Messiah on the day of Pentecost. That's the ending of the post-diluvian age. Read.
The present church age.
The church age or the assembly, the fourth age. That began on the day of Pentecost, as I said. That started here. And really, technically, this ended in 1960. This age. This present kingdom age. Technically ended in 1960. That's what the founder always speaks. And that we have always lived in an extended probation period since right. then. But technically, this age has come to an end. This fourth age, see, has come to an end in 1960, all right? And that we're still in this probation period. See, now some people will say, well, we're out of the, not in the fourth age, then we're in the fifth age. Well, no, we're not, for the simple reason. Now, spiritually speaking, you could say that, because we do have an immortal spirit dwelling in a physical body. And as far as Yahweh is concerned, all the ages is over and done with. So if Yahweh is in you, then all the ages are over and done with too. The only problem is we just physically have not caught up to it. But spiritually, dude, we're just waiting for the next set of ages. We're already past this. We're just walking through the mundane, if you will. But as far as Yahweh is concerned, it's over and done with. And see, and if Yahweh be in you, then it's over and done with you just as well. Just that physically, it just hasn't been made manifested. But the Father would say this, you do have an immortal spirit dwelling in a mortal body. And if it's immortal, see, then it's already gone through, it's already run its gamut. Revelations 19 and 10. Just to show you what I'm, just to give you a point of what I'm trying to say here.
Revelations 19 and 10. And I fell at his feet to worship him. And he said unto me, see thou do it not.
Mm-hmm.
I am thy fellow servant.
Uh-huh.
And of thy brethren that have the testimony of Yahshua.
Read.
Worship Yahweh. For the testimony of Yahshua is the spirit of prophecy.
Now the testimony of Yahshua is the spirit of prophecy.
Mm-hmm.
If I truly, or anybody, has the testimony of Yahshua, then I can sit up and tell you what's happening in these fifth, sixth, and seventh ages. If it's already happened in the spirit, then I should be able to tell you what's going on there. Even though physically, we haven't moved there yet, but spiritually, We've already gone through, so I should be able to tell you something, or anybody should be able to tell you something about the fifth, sixth, and seventh ages. Mm-hmm. Which from a physical point of view, it looks like prophecy. But as the scripture says, it's really the testimony of Yahshua. Why? Because he is the true Melchizedek that is walking through these ages. See? Where you have the ages?
The fifth age, the kingdom ages to come.
The kingdom and the ages to come. Now he said ages to come. The reason why he said that, because they have not yet manifested physically. If they go, they're not going to be physical. I mean, God, maybe I should maybe rephrase that. Maybe that's the wrong way to say that. They have not been made manifested. I'll put it like that. And they're not physical. You know, these are not physical angels. I'll get that straight. That was a poor choice of words. That's how I guess it just hasn't been made manifest. In a grand sense, but it's made manifest to you in here. See, that's why I say that when you die, you ain't going nowhere. Because if you're in Yahshua now, when you take off the flesh, you'll still be in Yahshua. So where did you go? All you did was just made a transition from the physical. You just made a transition, that's all, but you didn't go anywhere because you're in Yahshua. Mm-hmm. See, and he is moving through the ages. Kingdom age, the new earth state. The new earth state. Look here, over here. Here. I know it's got this image here, and it looks like, and it almost looks Christian-like. Because that's what the Christians, they say, and we can even go to the scripture. What this is talking about, Revelation, the 22nd chapter, just to give you an idea. And see, the fifth age is like the fifth dispensation, or the fifth step in the tabernacle pattern, or in the migratory trend. In the fifth step, the Israelites had to assemble around this mount. See, and Elohim spoke to them. See, here, on this plate, everybody had to assemble. And look, when everybody assembled, it was everybody. Not only souls of men, but angels and demons. Everybody had to be here. See? And what kind of garment you had on determined whether or not you got to stay at the wedding. See? If you didn't have the right kind of garment, how'd you get in here, buddy? Security?
Gabriel.
Out of darkness, renovation here. Come on up out of here. New earth, new heavens, new earth. Now, can I read Revelation 22nd chapter?
Revelation 22:1. And he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding out of the throne of Yahweh and of the Lamb.
Mm-hmm.
And in the midst of the tree of the streets of it, and on either side of the river, was there the tree of life, which bare 12 manner of fruit, and yield her fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations.
Mm-hmm.
And there shall be no more curse, but the throne of Yahweh and of the Lamb shall be in it, and his servants shall serve him. And they shall see his face, and his name shall be in their foreheads. And there shall be no light there, and they need no candle, neither light of the sun, for Yahweh Elohim giveth them light, and they shall reign forever and ever.
Okay, now, does that sound just like what happened to those folks out in the wilderness? See, what was the light out here? It was Elohim. It was the cloud by day, pillar of fire by night. Okay, it's the same thing, in principle. See, but it's just sitting here talking about, says the new earth state. See, the fifth age. See, but really, all it is just you. It's you inside Elohim, you and the bride, the woman clothed in the sun. That's all it's talking about in an elaborate way, and it's just talking about and saying it in a way so that we can look at it, have a point of reference, if you will. Okay? Because we go back to the textbook.
Number six, the perfect, the ages to come.
The perfect, and the ages to come. Now, I said the six was perfect. Now, some people would get confused with that and say, well, wait a minute, how is six perfection when I've been taught it's the flesh? It doesn't say perfection. It said perfect.
Right.
Look up the word perfect.
Perfect,
mm-hmm.
having all the required or desirable elements,
mm-hmm.
qualities, or characteristics, as good as it is possible to be. Synonyms: absolute, complete, total, real, out and out, thorough, thoroughgoing, downright, utter, sheer, errant, unqualified.
You got a Webster's dictionary over there? Use the hard one. Hard put Webster over there. Those are good definitions, but there's one word that should be in there that should say. See, because it's all good. They're all good. And we're going to read a scripture that's going to accentuate everything that he just said. But there's one word that I hope it would say. That I could bring it out.
Perfect. Conforming absolutely to the description or definition of an ideal type. Two, excellence or complete beyond practical or theoretical improvement.
Complete, that's a good word. Complete, read.
Three, exactly fitting the need in a certain situation or for a certain purpose. Four, entirely without any flaws, defect,
mm-hmm.
or shortcoming.
Mm-hmm.
Five, accurate, exact, or correct in every detail, a perfect copy. Six, thorough, complete, utter, perfect strangers.
Mm-hmm.
Seven,
oh God,
unqualified, absolute, perfect control. Eight, expert, accomplished, proficient. And nine, unmitigated, a perfect fool. Oh my gosh.
Just read.
designating a verb tense aspect or form, typically indicating the action or state extending up to or having results continue up to the present or some other temporal point of reference pertaining to be the consonant musical interval of an octave, fifth or fourth. Well, that's nice. To bring to perfection,
mm-hmm.
make flawless or faultless,
mm-hmm.
to bring near to perfection, improve, to bring to completion, finish. The perfect tense or aspect, a verb form or construction in the perfect tense or aspect.
All right, now, the six age, that's what the six age was called. No, don't get them moving up. There you go. The six age, perfect. Now, what does that mean? 1 Corinthians 15. And I'll start with 20.
20?
Yeah.
First Corinthians 15 and 20. But now is the Messiah risen from the dead and become the firstfruits of them that slept. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. As in Adam all die, even so in the Messiah shall all be made alive. But every man in his own order, the Messiah, the first fruits, afterwards they that are the Messiah at his coming. Then cometh the end, when he shall have delivered up the kingdom to Yahweh, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and all authority and power. For he must reign till he hath put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death, for he hath put all things under his feet. But when he said all things are put under him, it is manifest that he is excluded, which did put all things under him. And when all things shall be subdued unto him, then shall the Son also himself be subject unto him that put all things under him, that Yahweh may be all in all.
All right. Now that's the 6 days. That's the Baal here. What do you mean? This is Elohim. See, he's all complete. The bride is in him. He's complete. Here's the high priest on the Day of Atonement. He makes 3 trips up. The last trip he makes up, he has to put on the garments of beauty and glory. Mm-hmm. The 12 stones, the breastplate, that represents Israel. That represents the bride, the woman. He's putting on the bride, and he's taking on clothes and sins, and he's taking her up with him in front of the Ark of the Covenant. Now, that's just the type. He had to do this 3 times. But see, here, this is after the order of Melchizedek. He's just doing this once and for all. And see, when he transverses, see, the 6th age is him complete, ready to transverse or go into the 7th age. Read the 7th age.
The sabbatical. Ages to come.
It's the sabbatical. And ages to come. What? That's a completion of the whole week. The sabbatical. That's 7 8. See, and he's up in here. Because when the high priest went up in here, he had to flick the blood 7 times. That's completion. And then he had to make a figure 8 around this tabernacle and then come back out. See, that signifies a new beginning. When he comes back out, then he can throw the censer down. But when he comes back out, he's back in the holy place in front of the lampstand. Here he is coming back out from the Sabbath. See, 7 ages completed. 7 stars in his hand. The 7 ages are completed because he's in the midst of the 7 lampstand. He's got 7 stars in his hand, which signifies 7 new ages, because it's not 7 Elohim. Just 1 Elohim being manifested in 7 ages. See, Sanctum of Sanctorum. See, he himself is the Sanctum of Sanctorum. He's come out at the end of the, that's what the word ending at the end of the ages. That's him coming out. This is the 8th age, or this is the beginning of the set of a first set of ages, a new set of ages. But this is the completion here. That's what the 40th plate is representing. Yes, he is in the Sabbath, but he's come out of the sabbatical age. In the sabbatical age, he's in his rest. He's here. That's what this is pointing to. This is the 7th. Now we read the textbook. Yeah,
the Sabbath. The Sabbath is the day of Yahweh.
It's the day of Yahweh. That's here. Read.
Or the day before the beginning of the 8th, or the beginning of another series of ages.
See, that's before he comes out here. But here, that's why this, look, new heaven, new earth, plate 39, heaven. It says Sabbath all in all. Didn't we just read the scripture where it just said that Elohim, you know, must be, you know, first, you know, all things must be put under him, and then he himself must be made subject so that Yahweh might be all in all. It's right there on the plate. All in all, this is the 7th age. Why? Because it's like the high priest. And when he comes back out, this is what he looks like. Complete. 7 ages complete. 7 new ages. Here he is. Sanctum of Sanctorum. He himself is the Sanctum of Sanctorum. Mm-hmm. He himself is the Sabbath. He's still in his rest because he hasn't done it. He's at the beginning, just like Elohim here. When Elohim came forth from pure spirit, he was in his Sabbath too because he hadn't started his work yet. But then once he starts, then he comes out of the Sabbath.
And now he's doing some work. But at this point right now, he's just standing there. He ain't doing no work yet. But at a point in time, here he is. Creation being drawn out. The same way here. Here he is. He just finished. Just finished seven ages. He made it so seven new. See? And here we are. We're with him. Because he's wearing the breastplate. We are with him. So that means that we, within him, we will decide how these ages will be.
That is correct.
We're right there with him. And then at this point, we can look back and see, oh, now I understand why you even made ages in the first place, Yahweh. I mean, we'll see and understand more perfectly. Not that we don't understand now, because we can prophesy. The testimony of Yahshua is the spirit of prophecy. We're sitting up here telling you what's happening in these ages. Mm-hmm. Because it's Yahshua. It's Yahshua moving after the order of Melchizedek. See? Fifth age, holy place. Sixth age, this veil. Seventh age, most holy place here. Sabbath, all in all. Eighth age, or the beginning of a new set of ages. Because the eighth age is the same as the first age. Because the eighth signifies a new beginning. Mm-hmm. And the end is declared from the beginning. Okay? See, and that's what we're... And really, this is the law of the Spirit. This is the law of the Spirit of life that permeates through everything. See? And see, that's why terms are really important, and people can get into, you can get into arguments about it and stuff like that and try to be clever. For me, I want to be edifying at the best. If anything, I try to be simple and straightforward, and because that's the best way to edify, and that's the only thing you can do. Now, other folks may want to impress and be clever and so forth, but that's fine. I used to do that myself. You know, maybe I still keep a clever line or two, like the Greek, it must be Greek, sounds like Greek to me, that kind of stuff. But you really want to be simple and straightforward and direct as far as explaining these charts, these correlations, using the scriptures, using the pattern to understand what's going on here, okay? And that's all we're trying to do. Ezekiel 46:1, because that's the scripture that it says right on this plate right here. And that should tell you something. See, and there's a reason why it's there.
Ezekiel 46:1.
Mm-hmm.
Thus saith Yahweh, the gate of the inner court that looketh towards the east shall be shut for six working days.
Whoa. It will be shut for six working days. Wait a minute. What direction was it?
East.
See, look. The tabernacle faced east. All right? So now it says six working days. See, and the scripture is right here. So it says six working days or six ages. It will be closed. But read.
But on the Sabbath, it shall be open.
But in the seventh age.
And in the day of the new moon, it shall be open.
It's going to be open. In other words, the new moon means no moon or no law. No law of carnal ordinances. But spirit law. And its gate will be open. See? And the seventh age, this gate will be open. Why? And I point here, this will be open. Why? Well, didn't the Jordan River open up here? It's the sixth step. Wasn't the veil rent here in the tabernacle? Mm. This gate's going to be open so that
can
walk in.
Yeah.
The Sabbath. On the Sabbath. That's why that scripture is that this is the seventh age. Just like the high priest had to go up here. Just like the high priest had to go up here on the Day of Atonement. 7 foot of blood. Sure enough. But then he made, from here behind the veil, made that figure eight. That figure eight coming back out.
There he is, that figure eight, coming back out. See, the beginning of a new set of ages, because this is the seventh age here. See, fifth, veil is the sixth, the seventh age. And here he is, and this is just, now I can have the other one, one and two.
I want to make a comment.
Sure you can. In front. Before he says something, what I want to say is, here he's naked, and whereas here he's clothed. The reason why is here he's hidden in a mystery, whereas here he is now fully revealed. Okay. We see what the mystery is, fully revealed. Okay, Joe.
Two things. On plate one, he appeared to be naked, correct?
Yes.
And then he's fully clothed, right?
Yes.
Now, the comment I want to make is about the sixth dispensation.
All right.
Now, you talked about when Dr. Kinley moved the seventh, he moved the seven over and he moved the six over.
Uh-huh.
But on the six, you know, they didn't move the writing over.
Right.
But the writing should be under the six.
Yes.
So that you can come unto immortality, mm-hmm, in the sixth dispensation.
Yes.
As you said. And then it is then manifest in you that Yahshua Messiah is the Savior.
Mm-hmm.
But that also happened on the day of Pentecost.
Yes. Okay. Yes, exactly.
But to us, at the end of the age, we were unclothed. We had no clue about Elohim, at least when I came in. But in the sixth dispensation, we, through Dr. Kinley, witnessing and confirming, now we've come unto that immortality. But the writing is not under there, but it should have been. That was the comment I wanted to make.
Yeah, okay.
You don't mind elaborating on that?
I think you already did.
The reason why I brought it up, because it almost sounds like we'd have to wait to the seventh sabbatical dispensation to receive anything, which that's not what you're saying.
No.
I understand that, but I can see how one would perceive it that way.
Yeah, I mean.
But I understand what you're saying. I'm not disagreeing. Because if you look at those plates, I think it's 32 and on up to 40. If you look up there, it always goes to the most holy place where there is no veil there. Although, according to a purpose, there is a veil there.
Yeah.
But
I know.
You understand what I'm saying? Up here.
We're talking about here.
Yeah, but you got him right there too.
Yeah. See, because see here, and it's got King of Kings, and over here, Ruler of Rulers. All right, and then first and the last, and beginning and ending, and the Sabbath, and the seventh seal open.
Now, in order to understand that, you have to be dressed for the wedding.
Yeah.
No, nobody would see that.
You're dressed now.
Yes.
Very well said. You're dressed now. See.
But if I was a Christian coming here, only thing I'm going to see is the King of Kings being on the cross.
Yeah.
You understand what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And the ruler being still on the cross. Or they say he's in the spirit. They don't recognize what you just said.
You're looking for a rapture.
Yes.
See, and you're looking for a physical... You're looking for to come out of the atmospheric heaven or space.
Yes.
One of them heavens. See, because you thought you went up into one of those heavens.
Okay.
See. And that's the thing, see. Dr. Kinley, if I understood him right, he said, look, Yahweh is always in a state of now.
Yes.
You know, I mean, as far as Yahweh is concerned, this creation is over and done with, you know. But here we are in the physical body.
Yeah.
We're still going through the mundane.
Bring it home.
See, however, like that lampstand, seven branch lampstand, here's the fourth age. The spirit was poured out in the fourth age and extended three previous ages and extended forward. Okay, so the spirit filled it all up together.
Very good.
See? And that makes the parable of the penny more relevant. Because even though here we are down here now, we're at at the end of the story, at the end of the day, so to speak, an hour before closing, we're getting a penny. But here Adam and Noah and all of them, they've been working since the beginning, since 9 o'clock. And they get the same pay we get. And they're like, wait a minute, man, we've been out here a lot longer, man. We work, but the husband man said, I contracted with you for a penny, and you got your reward. So who are you to say, how I want to, how generous I want to be? See? And look, and they had to wait. Nobody waited longer than Adam. But yet, Adam knew he was not forsaken. See, that's why, this one scripture where it talks about Yahshua supposedly went down to hell to preach to them. See, people think that he went down into the grave. That's not. He did go into the grave, but not at that point when he died on the cross. That's not when he went into the grave to preach to the captives in prison. He went into the grave, through these dispensations.
Yeah.
See, Adam was dead spiritually, but the Holy, mankind was dead, but through the dispensation of these men, Yahweh preached to them, to the captives in prison, or in the graves, in these bodies.
Yeah.
He preached to them. So that when he resurrected, those who believed, they resurrected with him. See? And that's the same, and that resurrection is still going on today. Until this day, to the last day. Look, people are still trying to find the right color. It's like people know there's a wedding coming, it's a big affair coming. They're trying to find the right garment. Should I wear a tux? No, you need to wear. And this is what you need to wear. You need to wear spirituality, some immutability, some righteousness. This is what you need to wear. See, and this is what you need to get rid of. Because see, you come wearing this, it'd be like the parable of friend, how did you get in here without a wedding garment? And what are you going to say? Can't say nothing. Okay.
Play 1 and 2. You gonna say something about play 1 and 2?
Basically, I did. Other than, because he's new, that it appears like this is hidden in the mystery. This is at the beginning. See, this is at the beginning of the ages. This is at the end. They're both one and the same, but they're depicted differently to show forth a principle. That's all I wanted to say on that. This was hidden, because see, he comes out from behind the veil of inscrutability, but still, it's hidden in, we see what it is, but it's still a mystery. But then as we come down through the ages, through all the charts and all, comes down, now here he is, fully clothed, fully revealed. Because, see, we have been with him through the journey. So we have learned. See, the scripture says we'll be learning in ages to come. What is it that we're going to be learning in ages to come? Yahshua. Who else?
Nothing else.
It's Yahshua. So that, see, look, in this fourth age, here's the Spirit poured out. We have received that Spirit. Because we have received that Spirit, just like the scripture says, the testimony of Yahshua is the spirit of prophecy. That gives us the ability, look, to be honest with you, and it may sound crazy, but this gives us the ability to time travel.
That's right. That's right.
We can go back here and we can consult Adam, mm-hmm. and Noah, Enoch, or Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. We can consult all these guys. Not only in the distant past, but in the recent past. Mm-hmm. Dr. Kinley, Peter Godot, whoever we want to talk to, whoever's gone on. Mm-hmm. Edward Nixon, whoever. Glenn Kinley, you want to talk, you want to consult, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And not only that, but we showed you about the spirit of prophecy. Not only can we go, but we can also go forward and tell you what's going to happen in the fifth, sixth, and seventh ages. Now that's the power of the Holy Spirit. That's the power of Yahweh. See? And that's all that we're looking at. Because see, the ages and dispensations are like the tabernacle pattern. And El Melchizedek, who is Yahshua, is the priest that's operating through it. Once. Not three times, but just once. And once we become part of him, then we become part of everything that he's done, is doing, and will do. See? Now we're part of it. Now, that's why we can sit up and talk about this. We can transverse the ages. Before, we were stuck. We were stuck in, some of us in a post-diluvian type of mindset. You know, or even an antediluvian mindset. But now, we've been liberated from that. We traversed all the ages now. Back and forth. But for right now, we're stuck in this wineskin. That's the only difference. We're stuck in an old wineskin right now. And it can't, and it really cannot contain this great new wine that we got. You know, to the point that, we complain about our aches and pains and stuff like that, you know. More so now because we're knowledgeable, because of the new wine. That makes us more knowledgeable, and more sensitive. I say, oh, wow, this ain't nothing. I know for me, I hit my hand against it. It hurts more than what it did when I was 30. It does. It just hurts more, you know. I mean, you accentuate, you feel it more. And mentally, you just know, I say, yeah, I understand. You know, this is the flesh. This is the physical. You know, this is the mundane. This is something you just have to deal with, you know. I got to wash it. I got to eat. You know, if I get sick, I got to take medicines. You know, all of that. But I know in here that this is nothing. Because it's about the Spirit. It's about the Spirit. I guess that's about all I got to say about it. You want to say anything, Joe, or anybody else?
Sure, you.
Yeah. All right, y'all, clap now.
Clap, clap, clap.
And thank you.
Okay. I want to add to what he's saying tonight, because this was a very deep, difficult subject to understand. Let me have John 14 chapter, but I really want the 13th verse.
Can I have a little water?
And the reason for that is this. Paul said this. He said, wherefore henceforth know ye no man after the flesh. Even though we know the Messiah after the flesh, henceforth know we him, talking about Yahshua, no more after the flesh. He says, behold, all things are passed away. Behold, you're a new creature in the Messiah. Now, at the time, that was Paul saying that. But prior to that, they were looking at this natural physical body in their mind. In other words, as it was brought out, they were married to that carnality. So when Yahshua said things, they did not understand what he was saying. But this is one of the things he said. Let's read it. We're going to read on down to 20. Let's read.
14, 13?
Yes.
And whatsoever ye shall ask in my name,
back up that the will I do. I apologize, the verse before that.
Okay, 12. Verily, verily, I say unto you,
yes,
he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also.
Now look. At that time,
when the Messiah was walking around on the Palestine Judean hills, the only way they was able to do that is that he gave them permission, because the day of Pentecost had not yet been poured out yet. That day had not yet come. So the only thing they had to do was to look with their natural physical eyes and believe what they saw. Heal the sick, called the blind to see, the deaf to speak, you see, and the dumb to hear, and raising the dead. That's what he was doing, talking about the Messiah. So he said, if you don't believe me for my name's sake, at least for my work's sake, because everything is being resurrected in the power, you see, of Yahshua or in Yahweh. Let's read.
And greater works than these shall ye do.
Now he's prophesied, and read on.
Because I go unto my Father.
He said, now listen, I gotta take this flesh off. You guys gonna carry, you see, the torch. You see, read on, please.
And whatsoever ye shall ask in my name.
Now listen, I gotta take off the flesh. I'm gonna take it off. You're gonna carry the torch. But you gotta believe right now. You gotta believe that I am he that sent me. You with me so far? Because listen, they still think I'm Joseph the marriage boy. But I gotta do the work to establish your faith right now. I'm talking about in the post-diluvian age that was going on right then. You see, they did not have access to the kingdom or the gift of the Holy Spirit, and it had not yet come. But back here, he was performing the work, if you will. Let's read.
And whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son.
Now look, that I'm going to do for you, to prove that the Father is glorified in the Son, which is me. Let's read, please.
If ye shall ask anything in my name, I will do it.
Now look, I got to take this flesh off. But if you believe that I am he, then realize that I am with you. And just ask in my name, and I will deliver it for you. But you got to believe.
Right.
Let's read.
If ye love me, keep my commandments.
Read on.
And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that you might abide with you forever.
In other words, you're looking at me, you guys walk around, you look all tough, you know. You guys walk, we rolling together. You know, I'm healing the sick and the blind. You follow me? Call the blind to see, the deaf to speak, and the dumb to hear. And we all roll together. Oh, you looking mighty good now. But look, I'm going to take this body off. And you listen, the question is, I'll find out then if you believe. Then you have to carry the torch. You have to perform the very same work. But you got to believe. And to prove that they did believe, Peter, on the day of his crucifixion, denied him three times.
Yeah. Right.
Sure, that the Holy Spirit had not yet been poured out, and that power that was going to be given to them on the day of Pentecost, they had not received as of yet. But by permission, he gave them a taste to show them what they were going to do when he allowed them to cast out demons. Do you understand what I'm saying? Let's read, please.
The Spirit of Truth.
Now listen, this shape and form, the incorporeal body, the Elohistic body, whatever one do you, this shape and form is the Spirit of Truth. And it looks like a man, but it don't look like that. It is really, in reality, these attributes formed in you as you begin to understand and come into perfection. Because you ain't there quite yet. You see, but you got to come unto immortality, which is intelligence, wisdom, and knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength. And this is what was dispensed on the day of Pentecost. These divine attributes in the power of the resurrection. Let's read.
The Spirit of Truth, which the world cannot receive, because it seeth not him, neither knoweth him, but ye know him, for he dwelleth with you, and shall be in you.
Now look, that happened in the present kingdom. That's what opened it up. After he poured or dispensed his Spirit in this age, this is the fourth age, which lines up with our door, you have access to the enlightenment. You see, you have access to the sustenance which you can partake of. You have access to him who is praying the Father to you. That's why he said, if you ask anything in my name, I will give it to you. I will deliver it. Because, listen, I am with you. I am in you. Because I have confirmed and dispensed my Spirit, which I am, with those eyes that you see, that's who you are. Mm-hmm. Read, please.
I will not leave you comfortless.
He says, I'm not going to be here in the flesh. But if you believe that I am he, then you'll know that I'm always with you. That is what you believe. That's why there ain't nothing else but Yahweh. What else is there to talk about? But him. Let's read, please.
I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you.
Read.
Yet in a little while.
Look, at that time, he had not taken out the flesh. Mm-hmm. They didn't get it until the day of Pentecost. You see, when he dispensed grace.
Right.
You see, that's why this plate is right here. Talking about plate 32. It's showing forth the Passover supper, the washing of the disciples' feet, because he preparing them to officiate in the greater, more perfect tabernacle, which was already brought out today. It's us that's going to preach, you see, the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua Messiah. Mm-hmm. So therefore, he said, at this time, Peter, I'm going to wash your feet, but you don't know what I'm doing at this point. But on that day, you will know. Let's read, please. Oh, this was such a great class. Mm-hmm. Read, please.
Yet a little while,
read,
and the world seeth me no more.
Now listen, that includes you. See, in a few days, you see, at the point of time, I'm going to take this body up. I know y'all don't want me to go. You know, nobody, you don't want your parents to go. You know, hey, listen, I got to go. If I don't take this body off, I cannot be the comforter, and then I cannot fulfill my promise to you, who walked around with me for 3.5 years. Let's read, please.
Yet a little while, and the world seeth me no more, but read. You see me.
He said, but you're going to see me, even though I'm not here. You're going to see me. So folks want to think that, oh, we're not trying to give Dr. Kelly his due. We're giving him more than his due. Matter of fact, we are him.
Right.
How about that?
Right.
You see? See, it's through his teaching and his revelation that he revealed the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua's son. We found that the Yahweh Elohim is Yahshua. We also found out that we are him too, once we understand and enter into that kingdom. That's why it's right here. It's clear on the chart. Throne of Yahweh Elohim, new covenant written in heart and mind. Spirit law. That is your consciousness. That's where the reality takes place. Let's read, please.
Yet a little while and the world seeth me no more, but ye see me, because read. I live, ye shall live also.
Come on, read on.
And at that day, ye shall know that I am in my Father, and ye in me, and I in you.
What day is that? What day is that? I'm letting you know. It was not in the post-Illuminian age. I got to get that straightened out. That was in the present kingdom age. See, when he dispensed grace in that present kingdom age, you see, remember, he ascended to the Father, and 10 days later, he poured his Spirit out in the hearts and minds of men. Whereby now we have access to the kingdom of Yahshua Messiah. That's how we can be in him. You see? And that's why we're going to know at this moment, at that day, which is right now, that he is the King of Kings. You see? He is the ruler of rulers. He is the first and last, and he's the beginning and the end. That's why we got, look, the end, and we have the beginning right there in this little small space here. Showing forth cosmogony and eschatology. Showing forth he is the origin, or he's the beginning, and he himself is the end. Read that verse one more time. Let's read on so we can get out of here.
And that day ye shall know that I am in my Father, and ye in me, and I in you.
That day is the day of Pentecost. That day is right now.
Right.
It is at hand. It ain't coming up. It already is. Now the question is, when are you going to enter that day? Now when you enter that day, I'm letting you know you have become what you already are, Yahweh made manifest. See, you are Yahshua Messiah in the face of who you are. You are Yahweh in the face of whoever you are. If you understood any of this, you see, that's Yahweh taking that flesh off. A little bit more of that flesh, just take it off. I'm doing this, but I'm talking about your lies. The deception, that's been perpetrated upon you. That's what I'm talking about. You understand what I'm saying? Now, one more thing, we're out of here. Galatians, I think it's 4. I think it's 2 and 20. I think that's what I want. Maybe 2:14. And then we can get out of here.
2:15?
Maybe 14.
14? 2:14.
Well, Paul says, I die.
The one I saw that they walked
not up. It might be 2, I think that's where it is.
2:14?
2:14, I think.
Galatians 2:14. But when I saw that they walked not upright according to the truth of the...
I apologize, 2:20.
2:20?
Yeah.
Okay.
Galatians 2:20. Now, this is the kicker. Now, remember, at that day, you're going to know that I am he, right? Mm-hmm. He already brought it out. I'm just adding to it and confirming. Mm-hmm. So here, at that day, which is the day of Pentecost, now the Spirit has been poured out. You see? Now the assembly of Yahshua Messiah, you see, is being established on earth. Mm-hmm. And we're declaring his name right now. Not nobody else's name, but his name, which is Yahshua the Messiah. That's not going to change, folks. Mm-hmm. Because Yahshua is Yahweh of salvation. Right. All right? Let's read now. Now, this is what Paul says, who was not baptized by John. One might as well can throw that out. Mm-hmm. So you don't need no water to receive it. Right. You understand what I'm saying? You ain't got to eat no Passover suppers to receive it. You say, keep reading. Come on, read. I'm going to get y'all get out of here. Read.
I am crucified with the Messiah.
I am crucified with the Messiah. That's what Paul said. Read on.
Nevertheless, I live.
I live. Nevertheless, I live. Come on, read.
Yet not I.
But not I, Paul. Read on.
But the Messiah liveth in me.
But the Messiah that this shape and form. These attributes live within him. Read on.
And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of Yahweh,
uh-huh,
who loved me and gave himself for me.
That's what I'm preaching. That's the only reason I'm preaching and laying my life down, because it's all about him. I hope and trust somebody got something out of that. I was trying to add on to that.
Thank you. And that concludes tonight's lectures. Any announcements? Business meeting?
No.
Okay, we have classes here. Sundays, 11 to 1. Tuesdays, 7:30, 9:30. All donations can be had by Dr. Lloyd Lawless, their treasurer. Saul Stan be dismissed.
Yeah.
Now to him that is able to keep you from falling, present your fault with presence with seeking joy. Otherwise, allow him, our Savior, to ask us our sovereign, with our glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both for all time, now and ever, as I'll say.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Dude, I have bad neuropathy. It's like really slippery on my fingers. That's why I can't feel the button. I'm trying to feel the button.
Oh, wow. Okay, yeah.
You know, like, frustrating.